السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر، الله أكبر. لا
إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل ربه حتى أتاه اليقين، تركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا زائغ. Praise be to Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, the master of the day of judgment, the Lord of the universe. Indeed, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek His guidance, we seek His forgiveness, and we seek His help. And we bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is His final messenger, who delivered the message fully and faithfully and struggled in the sake of His Lord to do so until the day He met Him. When we look at our creation and our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we look at how He manages the universe, one thing becomes very clear, that the one who is in true control is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, something that is very interesting about our tradition, when you look at the ulama of the past, they discussed a lot of theological questions, أسئلة عقدية. But you may expect that they have delved really deep into the question of why is there evil? This is one of the very prevalent questions now, and it is a prevalent question in the Christian tradition, for example. But in our Muslim tradition, it wasn't such a huge question. It was something that they discussed, but it wasn't. Interestingly, a far more important question for them to wrestle with was our free will. How much choice do we have with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why? Because as Muslims, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of everything. And He has built in within the design of this world the good and the evil. And the ability for us to choose between this good and the evil. And so that we know that evil is part of the design of this world. Allah knew when He put Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam to the test that Iblis would come to them and he would trick them into eating from the forbidden fruit. And from that point on, there is the struggle between good and evil on this world. We know this. These are some of the basics of our faith. And therefore, a question that they wrestled with is, how much free will do we have? And how does this free will work with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Think about it. Yes, we have a choice. But how much choice do we have? We wake up and we start breathing. And most of our breaths are unconscious. Yes, we can control the breathing. But most of it happens without us thinking. The blood circulating in our veins, we don't have control over it. How our liver is functioning, we don't have direct control. We can't just give a command to the liver or to the kidney to tell it how it works. It works. You were born to parents and grew up in a society and experience so many things in life, many of which you don't have any control over. So the reality is the amount of things that you control is very limited. And the rest of it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala managing things beyond the scope of our comprehension and our control. We as Muslims don't believe in deism. What is deism? Is that Allah created the universe and just let it run. He put some laws in it, gravitational force, for example, and just let it run. We don't believe in this. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervenes. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is managing things actively. He's not passive. He is actively managing things. And in fact, one of the interesting discussions is how much control does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has when He says, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay, wallahu khalaqakum wa ma ta'malun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates everything. He's the one who created you and creates what you do. So this is a very interesting discussion among scholars like Aqidat al-Kasb and so on. Not a place to get into for a khutbah, but what we know is that our scholars understood that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervenes. Now that we've talked about the theory of it, what does this mean to us? Practically speaking, it means that in reality, we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that we do. And since He is the one in control, The best one to go to when we need help is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way He controls things is beyond our comprehension and understanding. He sees the long-term effect of everything that happens. One of the beautiful stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about is the story of Sayyidina Yusuf. His brothers plotted against him to throw him in the well. A young boy, shirtless, alone by himself. And subhanAllah, while this has happened, in fact, way before it, months before it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared a group of merchants who would gather their things and choose a route that would go by the village of Sayyidina Yaqub and Sayyidina Yusuf alayhum as-salam, and that they would decide to stop by that well specifically to get some water. And when they get the water up, they see the boy who is clinging on to it. SubhanAllah, had they traveled just a few days early, he wouldn't have been in the well. If they traveled a few days later, he would have died in that well. Sorry. And so, subhanAllah, you see this and you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meticulously planned those events. And subhanAllah, look at this. وَشَرَوْهُ بِثَمَنِ بَخْسٍ دَرَاهِمَ مَعْدُودًا قَالُوا يَا بُشْرَ هَذَا غُلَامٌ وَأَسَرُّهُ بِضَاعَةٍ. When they saw him, instead of doing the right thing, which is to actually go around the different villages and try to see who the family of that boy is so they can give him back, they decided to sell him because they know they're going to Egypt. And now they would get something out of him. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and eventually they sold him for just a few pennies. They didn't understand the value of this boy that was with them. SubhanAllah, who did they sell him to? The minister of Egypt. And at that point, as he was sold as a slave in a new country, new language, new culture, from being the favorite child with his father in a very loving home to a place where he is a slave, right? That moment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ مَكَّنَّا لِيُوسُفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This is the point where we establish Yusuf in the land. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the series of events that will happen, and without Yusuf actually going to Egypt, which was the highest civilization at the time, he would not have learned what he learned. He wouldn't have made the impact on the world that he had made later on. And so after he came out of the prison and then he was established as the minister of finance, that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said again, وَكَذَلِكَ مَكَّنَّا لِيُوسُفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This is the point where we establish Yusuf in the land. So the beginning of the journey, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the point where we established Yusuf in the land. The point where he actually became mumakkan, when he actually was established truly as a powerful man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the point that he is actually now established. And then later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of the descendants of the family of Sayyidina Yusuf in Egypt, came another young boy, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. And we all know the story of the baby that was put in the Nile in a small basket by his mother. And subhanAllah, that baby lands where? Near the palace of Fir'aun. And who sees him before Fir'aun, who had promised to kill all the young boys of Bani Israel? So if this news had reached Fir'aun first, he would have killed him. But subhanAllah, it reached who first? The wife of Fir'aun. Why? Because the tadbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way he managed things, is that long time ago, this very good woman would be married to this very evil man. And this very, very good, pious woman would have a very profound impact that would change the course of humanity. And that is when she sees baby Musa, alayhi salam, she immediately falls in love with him. وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي. And so she takes him and she convinces her husband to make an exception for this young Israelite boy not to be killed. And so subhanAllah, the way Allah manages everything with lutf, you know what latif is? Subtle. Subtlety. Things that we don't see. He's the one who knows how things are going to happen 10 years from now, 100 years from now, 500 years from now, thousands of years from now. Right? And he puts things together very slowly. We are in a rush to see results. Allah is not. Allah is not. He knows how to make things happen. But as things are being prepared, there are a lot of tests and trials and pain and suffering. And that is the nature of this life. This life is meant as a test, not as a place of relaxation, not as a place of just pure, unadulterated joy and bliss. That's Jannah. This life is meant to be a place of struggle, of strife. It has joy and moments of happiness, but also has pain and suffering and evil. That's just how it's made. But we have the conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees the big picture, and He knows that things will ultimately be good. We just need to have faith in Him and know that He is fully in control. As we say, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There is absolutely no power or might that I have except by that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me. قل قول هذا أستغفر. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. The first khutbah, we're establishing the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala huwa al-mudabbir. He's the one who manages. He's the one who controls. He's the one who's in true control of everything. And even though that we have free will, and I want to make sure that this is established so we don't come out having the wrong message. We do have free will and we do have choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has the veto power. So the choice that we have is by the allowance that, and the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when we make that choice, He has that veto power. Is that even if we want to go and, for example, to cheat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can stop this from happening. You will suddenly get a stomach ache and then you stay home for that day. He has the veto power to stop whatever He does not like to happen. This really puts us in a very empowered position, is that we know that the source of power is Allah. So why don't we go to the source of power directly when we need something from Him? One of the very inspiring stories that I have been hearing recently is a story of a person in Maryland. And he wanted to do something for his father. His father had passed away, so he wanted to do something in his name. Talks to a friend of his, and that friend of his is from India. So he tells him that, why don't you get that money and sponsor a hafiz there, a young hafiz. Okay, perfect. Give him the money, and the man sent it. After a week, this story that this man actually told me, his name is Zakaria. He tells me that after a week, the brother calls him. He said, did you send the money that I gave you? to the Hifd school? Said, yeah. Said, are you sure? Like, you actually sent it to your brother, right? He's like, yeah. He's like, and your brother actually gave it to them? Says, yeah, like, are you not trusting me or what? He says, no, it's not that. I'm just very shocked because last night my sister calls me and she says that she sees their father in a dream. He comes to her and he tells her, I have received the gift of your brother. This happened not 2 months ago. The brother tells me, he's an Amin, he's a trustworthy brother, subhanAllah. You see things where there's this sister who heard that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the doors of rizq for those who make istighfar, those who ask for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the Quran, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he says that if you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the doors of rizq and he will bring you rain and he will help your crops grow and he will just open the doors for you. Right? So she hears this and so she starts to make a lot of istighfar. Day and night, just lots of istighfar. Hundreds, thousands of times a day. Thousands of times a day. Astaghfirullah. Whatever, she's walking, she's going, she's cooking, she's going to, you know, on a commute, she's going to work, all of this. And subhanAllah, she said, after a couple of weeks or a month or so, she gets the call from the school that she works at, and they told her, sorry, we're letting you go. We don't need your services anymore. And subhanAllah, she said that had I not been on this quest of istighfar, I would have freaked out. She said, I know myself. But she said, subhanAllah, because of this, because of the istighfar and knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that promise, I received this news with the most peace that I could never have imagined. And I said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Not because I felt that this was a catastrophe, but because I know that there is thawab for Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So I wanted to get that reward for saying it, but I didn't feel it was a catastrophe. And subhanAllah, not too long after she continued to make istighfar and to have confidence in Allah, not too long after, she gets a better position in a school where? In Medina. And she said that one of the things that she was doing along with istighfar was as-salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, continuously making salah, right? And so she said that because of doing the salah, I started to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that I was yearning to see him. So the position came to her in Medina, the combination of istighfar and salah ala nabi. She clinged on to the source of power. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Right? He is the source of power. And so he changed al-asbab. He changed the means of this world for her, to make things happen for her. SubhanAllah. One of the very powerful stories of a man who was sponsoring an orphan. And his 4-year-old daughter drowned in the pool. Her heart stopped for a half hour. By the time he actually took her and took her to the hospital and so on, it was a half hour. They were able to revive her. And so subhanAllah, he said, how has this miracle happened? SubhanAllah, my daughter was saved. Keep thinking, he's like, I'm not very good with salah and, you know, all of this. He's like, subhanAllah, it's because of this orphan that I've been sponsoring. Perhaps this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved my daughter. And another story of a person who was sponsoring orphans and he was in a tight spot, but he didn't want to let go of the orphan, and so he actually paid the money. And subhanAllah, the following day, his aunt calls him and she says, like, I want to give you a gift. And it was 10 times the amount that he paid for the orphan. And it actually helped him a lot with a lot of responsibilities that he had to have for the house, and so on and so forth. These stories are a lot. The problem is we think very narrowly. We look at this world and we think, okay, these are the available paths for me. But the reality is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's in control, He can make things, He can make miracles happen for you. Ordinary people, wallahi, you don't need to be a sahaba or one of the great saints. Wallahi, Allah will open doors for you that you'd never expect. Before I conclude, I'm about to conclude inshallah, so it can be on time. I wanna just open the door of opportunity for you. This organization called Mercy Without Limits that I'm representing, alhamdulillah, is doing a lot of good work. From helping out, has helped out so much with the people of Gaza, and was able to actually get aid in, alhamdulillah, so in Ramadan, that was the focus, and we raised a lot of money, and we got a lot of aid in, flour, clothes, food, medicine, alhamdulillah wa shukrillah. One of the programs that we are in dire need for your support is the orphans. Especially that with us and every other organization working on Gaza, we have a lot of orphans that we are not able to renew their sponsorship because people shifted focus to Gaza. And actually some of these orphans are Palestinians. So these are before the genocide, not after the genocide, of course, because everyone is trapped inside. This is before the genocide in al-mukhayyamat, in the camps in Jordan. So we help a lot of these orphans, and Syrian orphans, and orphans from Sierra Leone, and Bangladesh, and Rohingya, alhamdulillah, a lot of these orphans. So we need your help. We need your help. It is just $60 a month, and it covers all the needs of the orphan, all the needs of them. And subhanAllah, there's so much barakah in it. So we would love to have your help if you can, inshallah, commit to at least a year. This is how we call it, our orphan has been sponsored. أَنَّا وَكَفِرُ الْيَتِيمِ كَهَتَيْنِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ The Prophet says, I with the sponsor of an orphan are like this in Jannah. And he put his two fingers together. So like very close. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he himself was an orphan. So if you can stop by, inshallah, we have donation forms and we have ways for you, inshallah, to pay. And if you can stop by and donate for this cause and sponsor an orphan, you also get updates from that orphan, so you know who you've actually sponsored, you see their progress at school, quarterly updates, and so on. Alhamdulillah, it's a very, very beautiful program. So inshallah, just do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and know that whatever you put into this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you tenfold. Whether it's actual money for money, so dollar for dollar, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will just put a lot of barakah in your life. Don't see it as taken away from you. See it as an opportunity to grow. With this, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all those who are oppressed, all those who are in need of help. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to be a means for good in this life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be elevated in this life and hereafter. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be in the companionship of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our sins to be forgiven. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our families to be blessed. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our kids to be protected. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we become the best of believers, a beacon of guidance, a role model community for others to follow. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be true dua. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory for the people of Gaza. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory for those who are struggling for their freedom. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be by those who struggle for His sake and to be against the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide good for all those who are suffering around the world. Allahumma ighfir lana ajma'in. وهب المسيئين منا للمحسنين، واجعلنا اللهم في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اجعلنا من عبادك الصالحين الهادين المهديين المصلحين. اللهم يا رب ارفع درجاتنا إلى أعلى عليين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين، وبالأخص أهالينا في غزة يا رب العالمين. اللهم كن معهم وكن على أعدائهم وأعدائنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا النبي الكريم.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
سووا واستقيموا. Strain your lines. Make sure the cell phones are silenced. Focus on the صلاة. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والضحى والليل إذا سجى، ما ودعك ربك وما قلى، وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى، ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى. ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى، ووجدك ضالا فهدى، ووجدك عائلا فأغنى، فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر، وأما السائل فلا تنهر، وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث. الله. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. ألم نشرح لك صدرك، ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك،
ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.